feel the loss of Russell, but today I want to remember him as the gentleman and gentleman that he was, and celebrate the fact that we lived when he lived, and we had a chance to experience this good man. There are going to be a number of speakers this afternoon, some music too, but since I'm the first one up, I'm gonna preempt all the speakers by saying what's on everybody's mind. The professor has left the island. I don't suppose there's anyone here who doesn't understand what that means, what that reference is, and if you don't, you're probably much too young. Okay. Russell David Johnson was born on November 10th, 1924, and died on January 16th, 2014. He was 89 years old, or as they say, a ripe old age. He was born in Ashley, Pennsylvania, just south of Wilkes-Barre. His father died when Russ was young, and his mother couldn't care for all six kids, so he and his brother were sent to Girard College in Philadelphia, a school for orphaned boys, from which he graduated, eventually with honors. He claimed that he was not a good student, but ultimately he was in the Honor Society. I don't know how you do that, but he did it. You see, in those days, fatherless children were considered orphans. In 1942, Russ enlisted in the Army Air Corps. I remember that, the Army Air Corps. It was way back then. And as history shows, he was a true war hero. He flew 48 combat missions in a B-25 as a bombardier in the South Pacific. His plane crash-landed while on a low-level strafing mission, and he broke both ankles. For his heroism, he was awarded a Purple Heart and several other prestigious medals, which are on display back there. Hope you get a chance to look at them. I remember seeing Russell when he dressed up, you know, like this, with a button in his lapel. He always wore that button. It was represented the World War II Victory Medal, one of his many awards, and he wore it proudly. After the war, Russell used his GI Bill to study at the Actors Lab in Hollywood and began a career that included many diverse roles in movies and TV, many times playing the bad guy. He was what they call in the business a heavy. He was a tough guy, and he was very good at it too. In preparing for this day, I searched out such diverse credits of Russell's as The Adventures of Superman. Yes, he was in that. Twilight Zone. The Attack of the Crab Monsters, and there's a poster of that back there, which he was kind enough to sign for me many years ago. He was good in those tough guy roles, even doing D's, Dem and Doe's guys, you know, hey, Muggs, come on over here, that kind of thing. R. Russell, yes, he could do that. His list of credits is too long to enumerate here, of course, but you all know the one that he is most remembered for, and that was the professor on the classic series Gilligan's Island. Incidentally, Russell gave birth to one of the great trivia questions of all time. What's the professor's name? Oh, really? Really? Are you gonna shout it out or shall I say it? Roy Hinckley was the professor. Also, I don't know if Dawn Wells, who's here with us too, do you remember Mary Ann's last name? Summers. If you get these questions at a trivia contest, you'll win yourself a drink. So Roy Hinckley and Mary Ann Summers. Now, the professor with both a good and a bad move for Russell, as it certainly typecast him as that character, and he found it difficult to shed that image when he went for other roles after Gilligan. Eventually, Russ came to accept this, though, saying it was a blessing and a curse. And in the final analysis, it was a wonderful job, and there aren't many actors who get the kind of recognition I do from their work. And he was recognized. One of his favorite stories from the years well past Gilligan's Island that I frequently heard him tell on himself was when he went into a Chinese restaurant to get takeout. The proprietor looked at him and said, "I know you. You were a professor." And Russell said yes, and the proprietor said, "Boy, you old." Russell was married 3 times, and his second wife bore him a son and a daughter. You'll be hearing from Kimberly, his daughter, in a few minutes. Russell was a strong supporter of AIDS research. His son, David, died of the disease. After Gilligan's Island, Russ never stopped working, even though typecasting hurt his opportunities. As I've mentioned, he acted in TV series such as Dallas, Big Valley, Lassie, Ironsides, to name just a few. He did voiceovers, radio shows, even recently voicing characters on video games. He was modern and up to date to the day he died. In 1998, on the occasion of the 60th anniversary of Orson Welles' War of the Worlds broadcast, the radio broadcast that frightened America. Anybody remember that besides me? No, I guess I'm not the only one. We recreated that program at Bainbridge Performing Arts for Island Theater, and Russell was first in line when I was casting the play, and he was damn good, too. There's a saying among we actors when we're questioned about being involved in a project that, let's say, may not be lucrative or a good credit or a big part. And that phrase is, work is work. I can remember sitting on the set of a movie that Russell and I did together, and we were waiting until they got set up. And we both looked at each other and we said, work is work. He loved acting, he loved being on the set, and he did so right up to the end. We're very fortunate to have with us today one of the two remaining stars of Gilligan's Island who has stories to tell. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dawn Welles, Marianne from Gilligan's Island.
Thank you. I'm not going to tell you all the stories I have. 50 years worth. It's our 50th anniversary this year. This is a very special time for me to be here with Connie and the family, and to remember Russell with such fondness and joy. It's really hard to be sad when you sit back and think of the things that you did together and the wit and the humor that he had. We were the rest. Sometimes circumstances, you know, bring people into your life just by chance, and they make such a significant mark in your life that friendship just becomes forever. That chance becomes your life's journey. Well, Russell Johnson, my professor, did just that. His intellect, his sensitivity, his honesty, his respect, his kindness, his sensibility, his talent, and his incredible sense of humor and wit captured not only my heart, but millions of fans worldwide is what I'm trying to say. Russell and I were the last two to get the billing, you understand that? Ironically, it became the rest. And such a great conversation piece, it formed a great bond between us. We used to send each other's cards, love the rest. I've been so privileged to have shared his friendship, witnessed his incredible relationship with his son and pride with David, his love for his daughter Kim and her mother, and for Connie's stepson, Courtney, and the love he shared with that dear, dear Connie. We are blessed to be sitting here today. I can't do this with the sense of humor you have. We all share that wonderful man, and we each hold our own special memory of Russell, our joyous times, our long conversations with depth, our shared laughter with his incredible humor and wit. I'm going to miss his twinkle, his gentle way, and remembering that true, true gentleman. Russell, my dear professor, we were the rest, but you were the best. I love you, and may God welcome you with open arms and a smile and a rowboat to boot.
Thank you so much. I'm looking around to see if our next speaker is here, and I don't think I saw them come in. So let me do the introduction and tell you what they were going to say, more or less. As I mentioned before, Russell was very active doing voice work here in the Pacific Northwest, and one of his employers and admirers is Jim French, who you all know from his long radio career here in Seattle. Jim produces what I call real radio programs, The Adventures of Harry Nile and Sherlock Holmes, to name just two of many. And I was hoping that he and his associate producer, Larry Albert, would be here, and maybe they'll show up later and we'll try and fit them into the program. But Russ did a lot of work for them, and I know he appreciated it. We had a lot of fun doing them too. Real radio programs with sound effects men and, you know, plots, and all that stuff. So now I'm going to skip ahead, and I would like to welcome Kimberly, Russell's daughter. Where are you, darling? There you are. Oh, yeah. Well, welcome to the club. They're nice. Don't worry.
Oh, you all look so wonderful. Okay. I didn't really write a speech. I just have some guidelines here, so. Okay. Dear Dad, I have a confession to make, and I thought that now would be a really good time. Do you remember that really mean third grade teacher that I had, who used to always get me in trouble all the time and pin notes to my sweater, and she was just so horrible? Well, anyway, back in the 60s when they gave you a test, they did it on that mimeograph thing with that funny smelling ink and, you know, that gray, that what looked like now recycled paper. Anyway, whenever you failed a test in my class, there was a line at the bottom of the test for a parent signature if you failed it. And you had to have one of your parents sign it and take it back in to her, you know, bring it to her on her desk. Anyway, I was really scared. I thought I was going to get in a lot of trouble. So what I did was I tore off the bottom of the test just where the line was, all frayed, just only where the line was. I just tore that off. And then he was sitting in his chair that night, and I came up to him and I said, Daddy, my girlfriend Cindy wants your autograph. And I gave him the paper, and he goes, what is this? Why am I signing this weird piece of paper? And I said, well, I don't have her autograph book, and so she likes to take little pieces of paper and paste them into her autograph book. So he's like, okay, I don't know. So he writes it, hands it back to me. And then I take a piece of tape where this whole thing is all frayed, and I just take one piece of scotch tape, and I just tape it back to the top of the page, just to the test. Didn't like rip anything else up to make it look. There's just this big broken part right where the line was, you know. And I taped it back in and I brought it into the teacher the next day, and she kind of gave me a dirty look and put it on her table. And from that moment on to this moment now, I had never heard a word about the whole thing. So I have two choices. I figured that either she saw that, called my dad, and he figured out what I had done. And he and my mother just laughed their butts off and said, you know, thanks a lot, click, we'll get back to you. Or I flew under the radar for that whole thing for my whole life. And I never told you this story, and I never told you about it because I know how you are, and I thought maybe you would, you know, feel bad that you were duped by a third grader, and either that or that you'd feel like a bad dad or something, not paying attention, you know, to that. But I used to do things like that. I was a weird kid. Anyway, when I was a little girl, people like to call me Russell with a wig on because I look like him a lot. And I really am such a chip off the old block in so many ways. When I was a kid, we had these swivel stools in our kitchen. And I would sit there and just swivel back and forth and talk to him while he cooked. And that was my way of spending time with my father. He taught me many things just by being my dad. And he loved to cook. He loved his friends. Absolutely his whole life. He just loved his friends. He loves everybody in this room. And he loved to entertain. He was at his best entertaining at Christmas and all the holidays. And he just absolutely loved that whole thing. And it was so nice to have a father that everybody liked. I really appreciated that. And when he was working, I can't tell you how many people have come up to me throughout my life and told me how much they loved working with him. I mean, kids of the actors would tell me that as well. He was a very gracious, he was a very well-mannered man, very prompt, very responsible, and I learned a lot of things from him, his graciousness. He used to call me twice a year to tell me to turn my clocks back for daylight savings. So a few years there, I decided I was going to beat him to the punch, and I started calling him up and reminding him to turn his clocks back. He loved that. So we kind of tangled back and forth with that. So many people that have said to me throughout my life, oh, I had such a crush on your father. And I always thought that was so sweet, but kind of irky at the same time. My father, I could always count on my dad. He was always there for me. I could rely on him. He was my rock. And I don't know what I'm going to do without that. Grow up, I guess. He loved his family, and he loved Connie so very much. They had a wonderful relationship, and I loved their relationship. And I'm sure all of you have experienced it, too, when you saw them together. All right. In closing, I would like to just give a quote from a little song that I always felt kind of related to me and my dad. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument and his song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just the living legacy of the leader of the band. I love you, Daddy. Thank you.
You did it. You did it. Good job. Beautiful. Just beautiful. Thank you so much. Russell, as we have seen and as we have known him, those of us who did, was a modest man, but like most actors, he kept files of his photos and headshots, thank goodness. I pulled some of them together in a slideshow, to which I now call your attention here on the screen. Thank you. Did I see Larry Albert come in during? So let's. Well, I'm going to skip back to the part I was saying about Russell was very active doing voice work here in the Pacific Northwest. One of his employers and admirers is Jim French, who you all know from his long radio career in Seattle. Jim French produces what I call real radio programs. The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, of Harry Nile, rather, and Sherlock Holmes, to name just two of many. So here, with some thoughts about Russell, is the co-producer and star of those dramas, Larry Albert. Welcome, Larry. No, come on up. Was the ferry late? And kind of you to admit that.
Well. I'm here to talk about loud microphones. Russell Johnson, the radio star. Now, you all saw him in movies and television, but I had the great good fortune of sharing microphones with him for many years. When I first met Russell, of course, I'm a movie buff, not a scholar, I'm a movie buff. I like B-movies, science fiction, old serials, and then I watched Gilligan's Island in Vietnam when they sent it to us there. And we didn't think it was so stupid. In Vietnam, we thought it was hysterical, and it lightened our day a lot. But when I met Russell, I walked into the room, and I was, as my daughter says, gobstruck, or smacked, whatever they say, and hesitated to walk up to him, because he'd worked with some of the major people in the industry, and finally, I worked up enough courage to go up and introduce myself, and he shook my hand. He was very gracious. Now, Russell, from my experience, was a consummate professional, and would be really upset that I was so late, but I would have lied and come up with something else. But we played against each other many times on radio, actually got him into a Sherlock Holmes. Now, he did not have a British accent, and he thought he did, but he didn't, and we made him an American Secret Service agent. In order to get him into a show, we brought Sherlock Holmes to the United States and saved the Washington Monument. That's pretty good in a little studio above a garage in Bellevue, Washington. Russell would take on any part. He didn't care about the size of the lines. He wanted to work, and he wanted to do the radio shows. We don't pay a lot. What we pay, which is a SAG-AFTRA contract, it is a professional company, wouldn't buy a good dinner. But Russell did it anyway, and he would come over from here, no matter what time the recording was or where, and we record six times a year in front of a live audience. And he would walk out to thunderous applause. Always introduced as the star, one of the stars of Gilligan's Island. Well, I thought he should be known for more than that. So when I would introduce him, I would say the star of Black Saddle, and various films, and working with Edward G. Robinson to expand on who he was. The last time we worked together was a few years ago. It was harder for him to come over, and he had to climb 13 stairs to do it. And he played a conniving, opportunistic judge a few days after, months after Pearl Harbor, when Los Angeles thought they were being attacked by the Japanese. And we titled the episode simply Ed. Now, we'd never have Russell play a bad guy before. He was really good at being bad and slimy and disgusting. And I play Harry Nile in the Harry Nile series, and sitting there with him telling me we're talking to each other without his pants on. Now, if you've ever stood across a mic or stood next to Russell, and the idea, except for Connie, seeing him without his pants on in his 80s didn't thrill. He did 23 shows for Jim French starting back in the 90s. I was fortunate enough to do several Harry Nile adventures with him. We got to act intimately, somebody was going to blow our brains out, and Russell could convey anything with his voice. He could act. He could act in any medium. And I'd like to think we were friendly acquaintances. We didn't socialize outside of the work. But he told me the joke that he's probably told many of you many times about the professor and why Ginger and Marianne live together in Hutt, and why the captain and Gilligan live together, and Mr. and Mrs. Howe, but why didn't the professor have anybody? And Russell said, well, he did. He had a girlfriend. And this is not what I expected, because I'd watched the show, and I said, well, how come she was never on camera? Oh, you saw her a lot. Well, what was she? Her name was Babs. Don't think about it. Anyway, Connie, I want to thank you for sharing your husband with me and my friends and many of us. He was a wonderful man to know and to work with, and he brightened up my life tremendously. Thank you.
Well, Larry Albert, thank you for making the trip across the pond.
Next time, move it closer.
Yes, we'll move it closer. Let's see here. Okay. Russell was a well-known figure on Bainbridge Island, whether walking the dogs or going to the post office and picking up fan mail, shopping at Town and Country, where he was not bothered by people, and I don't know if that was a good thing or not. I mean, you know, people knew who he was, but they left him alone. That's one great thing about the island, is you can be by yourself on the island, even if you're Russell Johnson. I spoke with Sid Cox, who is here today. Where are you, Sid? Back there. You all know him as the one of the post office clerks. He's the one all the way to the left at the Bainbridge PO. You have to walk in and walk past all the others that get there. He and Russell had a great friendship, one reason being that Sid handed Russell his daily pile of fan mail. Russ dutifully signed photos and sent them back via Sid in the post office, often coming in once or twice a day to do it. In addition, Sid told me that he would show Russ the latest celebrity stamps from the post office, and Russ frequently knew the star and had stories to tell. Can you imagine knowing someone who's on a U.S. postage stamp? Can you imagine? Well, I knew Lincoln, of course, but that's...
You get what I mean.
Russell shopped at Town and Country, and I would frequently see him there walking the aisles with his shopping list. When the checkers and the stockers and the baggers at TNC heard of Russell's passing, I asked our next speaker to say a few words on behalf of those whose lives he personally touched. Here is Terry Wagg. Terry, where are you? Oh, there you are.
You all look familiar.
You know her.
Wow, what a gift. We call, I guess I'm titling this, Our Island Treasure. And I found this quote as I was just looking at some books as I was preparing what I wanted to say, and by Tom Brokaw. Russell was one of those men whom he wrote about, one of the greatest generation, who came of age during the Great Depression and the Second World War and went on to build modern America. Men and women whose everyday lives of duty, honor, achievement, and courage gave us the world that we have today. And Russell was one of those men. He was a brilliant diamond with many facets, intricately cut, shining wherever he went. In talking with his friends, at Town and Country, customers and all of us that work there. They all, every one of them, when I mentioned his name and asked what came to mind when they thought of Russell, first bore just a giant smile because he brought joy to everyone's hearts. These are some of the words they had for him. Genuine was repeated about 10 times. Humble, compassionate, funny, unassuming, kind, determined, generous, down to earth, so sweet, gentle man, gentleman, hero, predictable. Predictable was from Jeremy in the wine department, who said the next sentence was McManus Merlot. Self-sufficient, and someone, it blurted right out, she said, "What a hunk!" Of course, remembering Gilligan's Island, and he still is. The last time I waited on Russell, about a week before he passed, he had a couple bags of groceries, and Heidi, who was always trying to get him to let her help him out, said, "Can I take you out?" He said, "Not yet," and grinned. He wasn't chatty, but seemed to touch every life at Town and Country and throughout Bainbridge when we observed him, often without words. One of my favorite quotes by St. Francis says, "Preach the word daily, and if you have to, use words." Russell spoke volumes just by being who he was, and now we all have a chance to let our lives shine as brightly as he did wherever we go, because we don't know how long we have here, but we sure can shine today. We look forward to seeing you again soon on the Big Island, Russell, and we thank you for giving us all the gifts that God gave you to share. We love you.
Thank you, Terry. Thank you very much. Yeah, Russell, I'm going to go off script here. Russell was one of those guys that you could talk to, that you could be with, and there was no pretense about the man at all. He was a big star, you know. He was a big star. Gilligan's Island was huge. And yet I saw him, you know, when people would walk up to him at the market, for instance, and say, "Are you the professor?" He'd say, "Yes, and can I have an autograph?" And so, and he was just as gracious could be. He was a blessed man. And we were blessed to be in his presence. I'm going to call on you now, Tom, if I may. Dr. Tom Hagar and his wife Priscilla were not only good friends and neighbors of Russell and Connie, but he also was Russell's doctor through some troubling times. He asked to be included in today's program. Dr. Tom Hagar.
I never met the professor. I didn't. Never knew the professor. During the 60s, I was in college and in medical school. There wasn't a lot of television time. But years later, I had a good buddy named Russell. It was Valentine's Day, exactly 24 years ago, yesterday, when my wife, Priscilla, gave me a very romantic Valentine's Day present. It was a big concrete septic tank from Fred Hill Materials. And when they hooked it up to our new home, we got an occupancy permit, moved in, and that's when we met Connie and Russell, our next door neighbors. Now, Connie and Priscilla loved movies. Russell and I, however, preferred the sweet science, boxing. And Connie and Priscilla would often go to movies, and they would always invite us, but they really hoped we wouldn't go. So they'd choose chick flicks and these romantic comedies, things that didn't really appeal to Russell and I. So one evening they said, "You know, Tom, Russell, you want to go to the movies?" "Oh, what's the movie?" And they said, "No, no, thank you." So we got a night off. Russell calls me up. He said, "Tom, there's a good boxing match on tonight. Come over, I'll cook dinner." Great. So I show up and go in, and I don't smell anything cooking. I get a little nervous. And Russell said, Tom, you like hot dogs? And I said, love them. He says, well, I'm really good at hot dogs. He says, come on out. So we go in the kitchen. He opens up the fridge, takes out this package, two wieners. But these aren't those two-week-old, the last two ballpark franks in the thing. These are wrapped in white butcher paper. They come from that department. They're in the real casing. They pop when you bite them. I mean, these are good hot dogs. So he carefully picks one up like it's a filet mignon, goes to the microwave, places it precisely, precisely in the center of the microwave, and he carefully dials up 47 seconds, pushes the button. 47 seconds later, ding, takes out the wiener, puts in a bun. You want mustard? Yes, thank you. Shh. A couple potato chips, a pickle, and he hands me the plates. Here's your dinner. He says, don't wait for me. They're better when they're hot. So I say, okay, and so I take a bite of the hot dog, and he takes out the other wiener, his only wiener, the last wiener, carefully puts it in the center of the microwave. Carefully dials up exactly 47 seconds, pushes the button, and he turns his back on the microwave, and he's talking to me about the fight and so forth. Just a few seconds later, I hear a buzzing sound. I smell some like electrical ozone sort of smell, and I see little puffs of smoke rising from behind Russell. And then a moment later, there's some flickering yellow light in the room, and I'm starting to get a little nervous, so I look around him. I can't believe my eyes. Through the glass door of this microwave, I kid you not, flames, and it was dripping like flaming balls of lava were dripping down onto the base of this oven. And I, Russell! So I pushed past him. I tried to get the cord to unplug it, and it's going behind a bunch of cookbooks right below the wooden cupboard. And I'm seriously a little nervous here. So I go to find the plug, and I couldn't find it. Russell shoves me aside. I know where it is. And he goes around. He reaches behind the cookbooks. He unplugs the microwave. It continues to drip molten lava and continues to smoke. So I grab the microwave, I go around the counter, through the sliding door, out onto the concrete patio, safe distance from the house. I put it down and go back inside. And I'm going like this, you know, and Russell's, oh, he says, I bought that microwave 20 years ago at Sears. It's been a great microwave, and I don't know, but you know, I can always get a new one. And so we finally sort of settled down. And then I pick up my hot dog, take the second bite. Russell looks at me, and then he kind of looks at the counter. He says, Tom, where's my hot dog? I said, well, I think it's out on the patio. So Russell says, would you please go get it? So I head out to the patio thinking, this is a waste of time. And I'm also thinking, when I get back in, the last half of my hot dog is going to be gone because there's no more wieners here. But I get out there. I kind of touch the microwave. It's not hot. It's warm. I open it, and one more puff of smoke comes up, and I cough a little bit. I look in. I can't believe my eyes. I mean, the floor of this microwave, molten, charred, ashen plastic around the periphery, but in the center, a perfectly cooked, golden brown hot dog just starting to split. I'm amazed. I pick it up, take it in, give it to Russell. He looks at it. No black spots on this hot dog. Puts it in a bun, a little mustard. He takes a bite. And then he gave me that little Russell look where he leans forward. He's got the twinkle in his eye, kind of like this. Little smile. He said, it's a little smoky, but it's just the way I like them. Let's go watch the boxing. So we did. Well, you know, in the last month now since Russell died, I've often thought, you know, where's Russell? Where does someone go when they die? Where do they go? And I haven't come up with the answer, but I'm confident when I think back on Russell's life, and when he went down in that bomber and lived to tell about it, somebody was looking over him and protecting him. And when that tidal wave and that typhoon came along and swept him off that island in the 70s, and he was saved, someone was looking over him. And when that hot dog survived that inferno in that microwave, I think you're getting the idea. Someone's looking over Russell's shoulder and taking care of him. So Russell, I just want to say, may all your landings be smooth, may you never get lost, and and may all your hot dogs be a little bit smoky.
Tom Hagar, thank you. Wonderful story. Connie and Russell shared some favorite music, and here's one that they enjoyed together. We're going to listen now to Linda Ronstadt's recording of the beautiful Blue Bayou. And I suggest that as you listen, just please think about Russell and what he meant to you.
So bad, I got a worried mind. I'm so lonesome all the time. Since I left my baby behind on Blue Bayou, saving nickels, saving dimes, working till the sun don't shine. Looking forward to happier times on Blue Bayou.
Dr. Richard Golden is a good friend of the Johnsons, and he's going to honor them and us with a reading of one of their poems. Dr. Golden? Thank you.
Before before I read the poem, I want to tell a little story. Many years ago during football season, my wife Linda and I would spend Sundays at the Johnsons watching the Seahawks get clobbered by one team or another. And it was always fun to be there with Russell and Connie. Russell was very knowledgeable about football. We'd argue about the best quarterback or the worst linebacker, what went on in the game. Well, one year, Connie and Russell invited us to Super Bowl Sunday. And we declined the offer, saying we had friends coming from Seattle and elsewhere, and we were having a Super Bowl party at our house, kind of a potluck. But they were welcome to join us at our place if they wanted to. They declined the offer, and we went on about our business. Well, Sunday morning, Linda was preparing food for our Super Bowl gang, which was on the ferry, and a friend walked in and asked her what she was doing. Linda said, "I'm getting ready for Super Bowl Sunday." And the woman said, "I didn't know you got Channel 13. We said, "Well, we don't get Channel 13. "Well, the Super Bowl's on Channel 13. So Linda called Connie and said, "Connie, remember you offered to..." And Connie said, "Oh, yes, I remember that. Well, how about we come over? We'll bring the food and 10 other guests." And Connie said, "Bring them on over." So we all went to Connie's house, and Connie and Russell entertained us and all our guests, and we had a great Super Bowl. It was that quality of those two, the graciousness, the openness, the embracing quality of Connie and Russell, that I most love, and I'll miss that in both of them. Of course, we still have it in Connie. She's enough for everybody. So I'm going to read the poem that's on the back of your program. So you can read along or just listen. Now, Rumi was a 13th century Sufi master, and he wrote this poem called "The Guest House." This being human is a guest house. Every morning a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness. Some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all, even if they're a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture. Still, treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing. Invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. Well, Russell, God bless you. Keep an eye on us. Help us all through the rest of our lives. And enjoy wherever the heck you are at this time. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. When was I supposed to do Linda and the LA City Council? Right now? Is this the time? Oh, there you are. Good. Okay. I can't remember where I was supposed to be in the program, but this is as good a time as any. Linda Bybee from the LA City Council has a presentation to make.
Thank you. I'm Linda Bybee, and I, in the interest of full disclosure, been a friend of Connie and Russell's for many years, and was formally integrated into the family for a while, and wife of Courtney Dane, and we have a son, Max Dane, who is here also today. Many of you who may not wish to self-identify are expatriates of Los Angeles, so you know how important a city it is, and especially for the career that Russell Johnson had. Allow me to read this, and this comes signed by each and every one of the Los Angeles City Council, also with the awareness that David Johnson, Russell's son, served as the first AIDS coordinator for the City of Los Angeles at a time that was a very courageous position that he fulfilled in the city. City of Los Angeles, State of California, certificate of tribute is hereby presented to Russell Johnson posthumously. As a longtime resident of Studio City and an acting professional, Russell Johnson brought life to television villains, mystery and awe to science fiction, fostered romance on stage, and embedded the art of critical thinking into the hearts and minds of millions as the iconic professor on the internationally beloved television sitcom Gilligan's Island. He is remembered by the people of the City of Los Angeles. In reruns, Russell Johnson will be forever young, and in his passing, he will be forever loved by those who knew him well. Thank you for this opportunity to make this presentation to the family. And politics was very important to Russell, as it was for the vets who have served this country, because they know what it is they're fighting for. So it's my honor to present this to you.
Very, very, very nice. I have a friend. I do? Yeah, I do. His name is Mark Evanier, and he maintains one of those internet blogs. Is there anybody younger than I am who knows what I'm talking about? Oh, good, good. The blog helps me to keep in touch with some aspects of our industry that interest me. He writes about those who pass away, often with personal reminiscences. And he did one for Russell that I'd like to share part of it with you. I'm not sure whether we should feel sorry career-wise for Russell Johnson. I read this in one of his obits today. He admitted he had trouble finding work after Gilligan's Island, having become typecast as the egg-headed professor. But he harbored no resentment for the show, and in later years, he and other cast members, including Bob Denver, who had played the bumbling first mate Gilligan, often appeared together at fan conventions. I only met him once briefly. This is Mark Evanier speaking. I only met him once briefly at one of those. He was an awfully nice, friendly guy, not just to me, but to everyone. He sat patiently next to Marianne and answered all the same questions for the 80 millionth time. Elsewhere in the room, there were actors with no customers for their signed photos. Some of them were fine actors who'd played hundreds of roles on TV shows, but they never managed to snag that regular part on a popular regular series. I hope Russell Johnson looked around that room and recognized his success and the affection of his fans. And now it is indeed an honor to welcome Dave Cook of the Cook Family Funeral Home, who will conclude today's program by presenting the military honors and the color guard. David?
Thank you, Frank. I just, if I could, before we turn the time to the military, just make a short little comment. It's not often that the mortician gets to meet the person who passes away, but Russell, I learned a lot about him and his sensitivity, and especially his love for Connie. Probably about 3 years ago, when he made an appointment to come in to see me because he was determined to prearrange his services and to have everything prepaid and taken care of, signing his own cremation authorization, all of these things, just so that would take a burden off of Connie. And I remember Connie not wanting to come into that door very easily, but we can all learn that from Russell as well, his sensitivity, knowing that time was short, and his love for Connie and wanting to make sure that was easy as possible. We'll now turn the time over to our active military, and Staff Sergeant Dane, Russell's grandson, will do the flag presentation.
Thank you.
Wow. At the very start of today's program, I referred today as a celebration of Russell Johnson's life. And it certainly has been that. Many thanks to all of you who came and all who participated. And now, as is fitting for an event such as this, we're going to dance our way out of here with another of Connie and Russell's favorite music, the Dixieland music of the Dave Brown Dixie Combo Band. Where are you guys? Hit it. And refreshments are being served back here. My bad. Thank you for coming.